Welcome back, everyone. Today we are reviewing the X-Files Season 8 episode, Permanum. Lot to discuss in this episode. A lot of things I love, a lot of things I fucking hate. So let's get right into it. Permanum is a pretty good cross-section of how the X-Files views, portrays, and treats women in its storylines and even in its creation. Like, it's a very good example of just how little to no input women had in the creation of the show, especially in the series discussion of things that circumstances that affect thousands of women every fucking day. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. there's scenes in this episode that are really good. And there's some great Scully Doggett moments. There's some great Scully Skinner moments. There are some Mulder Scully moments, and I'm not going to call them great. We'll get to that scene. Actually, the Mulder Scully moments in this episode are what most fans know this episode for. And let me be the first to say I fucking hate them. So, the good and the bad and the ugly. Let's talk about it. Permanum. I want to point out how the opening to this episode is almost shot for shot the opening of the season 4 episode, Small Potatoes. It has a woman going into labor. She has been sexually assaulted in a way where it is rape by deception. And she has been impregnated with a child whose father is not her partner. And she's been essentially raped. And it's shot for shot that. She gives birth. It's very traumatic. The doctor takes the baby away. He's like, oh, the baby's fine. Nothing's wrong with it. And then you see it, the big reveal. The baby is not a human baby. It's an alien hybrid child. It's shot for shot the opening of Small Potatoes, which is a celebrated episode of The X-Files among many fans. That is clue one to this episode, being a cross-section of how this show views women and circumstances like sexual assault. Because many fans celebrate the episode Small Potatoes as one of the best, most comical episodes of The X-Files. And it's an episode about fucking rape. So that is a very good example of what this show thinks of these very triggering subjects. That it's a fun little science fiction subplot. And we'll see more of that as this episode goes on. Fuck me. So, this woman is named Mrs. Haskell. And you get the opening credits. And then you see Scully. And she is about 14, 15 weeks pregnant. This is a circumstance I think, I would say most pregnant women have done this behavior since the world began, probably since there were human beings walking the face of the earth for millions of years. Scully like looks at her tummy. She's trying to see like how big her baby bump is. She's looking at the ultrasound, and goddamn, like, it's a beautiful moment. Like, Scully's wanted this baby for so long. It's a miracle to her, but it's also really fucking sad. Like, you know, she's going to fight with everything she has to give birth to this child and have it, and it's just going to be ripped away from her. Like, it's, I wish I could go back in time when I was 15 and like watch the X-Files and just stop at season 8 and be like, okay, this is the end of the show, you know. Goddamn, it's like every joyful moment Scully has, it's just going to be taken away from her. Like, we'll talk more about it. So then she comes into work, and Doggett's there with Mr. Haskell, who's a complete and utter nutbag. And Scully gets this look on her face. She's like, God damn it, Doggett. I haven't even had my sad pregnant lady tea yet. So, many doctors in the United States, which is where I'm from, will tell pregnant women, like, you don't need to consume a lot of caffeine. It's bad for the baby. And so many pregnant women, at least in my social circles, will not drink caffeine. They'll give up coffee and soda and chocolate and tea, you know, and, in favor of these herbal teas. And when I was pregnant, the joke in our family was, yes, Anastasia's drinking her sad pregnant lady tea, which is spot on of what Scully's probably doing right now. So she's like, God damn it, Doggett. Mr. Haskell is like, my wife gave birth to an alien baby, which sounds like a fucking TLC show. Anyway, Scully tells him to make tracks. And then she walks up to Doggett, and Doggett's like, hey, what Mrs. Haskell went through, who Mrs. Haskell is now dead. God damn it. We'll get into it in just a second. Fuck me. The reproductive trauma in this episode and in this series and how it's handled is terrible. Anyway, Scully walks up to Doggett, and he's like, hey, this is what happened to you. And Scully gets this look on her face. I just want to say Scully's luscious pregnancy hair and lips. Goddamn, those pregnancy hormones, right? She walks up to Doggett. She gets this look on her face. She's like, hey, bro, I'm going to wreck your shit. I'm going to wreck your shit if you don't get out of my beeswax. And I don't know what Scully's doing to pull these guys who are very turned on by the fact that she could beat their asses. But goddamn, does Dana Scully get them. She looks at Doggett, and he gets this look on his face, and he's like, yes, mommy. I wish you would punish me. people kind of get this feeling about Doggett that he's taciturn and, like, this like, rigid New York detective, and he's, like, a stick in the mud. He's kind of a freak. I mean, there's a reason John Doggett's down in the basement with the X-Files, okay? Like, I could see Doggett having some freaky inclinations. Like, I want this small woman to beat me. Like, which Mulder absolutely has, too. A lot of parallels are drawn in this episode between Mulder and Doggett. We'll talk about that in just a minute. So Scully's like, hey, stay out of my business, bro, or I will kick your ass. And Doggett's like, that's exactly what I'm trying to get you to do, you know. So Scully goes in the elevator, and this is when the flashbacks start of her and Mulder. Let me say, they call David Duchovny back for this episode, and I have no idea why, because he can't put less effort into this performance. These are some of the most emotional moments in the series. David Duchovny cannot even look at Jillian's face. He's looking like a spot on the wall behind her. I mean, there's David Duchovny's shitty acting, and then there's David Duchovny's shitty season 8 X-Files acting. I'm not even going to call it acting. It's just like showing in and showing up and phoning it in. Like, he's not even phoning it in. He's like, I don't even know what he's doing. He's not acting. It's terrible, okay? You can tell he's not fucking interested, all right? And it kind of ruins the moment, or part of it ruins the moment. So throughout this episode, Scully has these flashbacks of Mulder, and he's, like, coming into the elevator and holding the door and talking to her, and then the flashback will cut back to the present, and Doggett will be in the exact same position Mulder is. And goddamn, is it ever Scully Doggett shipper bait. And you know what? I'm fucking here for it. I am the number one Scully Doggett shipper, I think. That's safe to say, in my social circle, online and not. Yeah, they would have been fucking hot together. Now, preferably, I ship Doggett and Scully and Reyes in a thruple. And goddamn, we'll get to Dominicus, which is the a season 9 episode, and goddamn, is it ever like, yeah, they're in a throuple, they're in a threesome, okay? Just fucking call it what it is. They're all fucking. I also really believe if Mulder had not come back, Scully would have pursued a relationship with Doggett because he is down bad for her. All right, I think that's safe to say. And I think Scully's attracted to him. She's just like, my baby daddy's out there and I gotta find him. And she's not going to pursue this with Doggett. I think if Mulder hadn't have come back, it would have done us all a favor. I mean, let's just be real. I mean, and she would have gotten with Doggett and had a great stepdad for a kid. That's the way I wanted it to go, but fuck me. Anyway, I'm going to write all the fanfics of Reyes, Doggett, and Scully being in this polyamorous relationship and raising William, which is how the show should have ended, okay? Fuck season 9 and fuck the revival, you know? So, and fuck all the revival defenders, that's what I have to say. No, I take that back. If you love the X-Files revival, that's great, I support you, it's just not for me. I think it's garbage, but that's my opinion. If you love it, great, good for you. So anyway, she has this flashback of where she's talking to Mulder. Many people put this in early to mid season 6, and I think that's fucking rich. I'll talk about that, why I think it, in just a second. She's talking to Mulder and she's like, you know, the doctors tell me I can't conceive a baby and I'm really bummed out about this because that's what I wanted. And then Mulder leaves the elevator. He doesn't even stay with her to give her this news. He cracks the elevator door open and is talking to her through the elevator door. And he's like, oh yeah, LOL, by the way, when you were sick with cancer, I found your ova and I held on to them. Now, if we're placing this in mid-season 6, that's been almost 2 fucking years. And Mulder's like, you were deathly ill, and I didn't want to trouble you with this. So I just walked around with your ova in my fucking pocket and then thought to take it to a facility where it would be kept safe. That was 2 fucking years ago, Mulder, and you never thought to tell Scully that. That you held her ova without her knowledge or her consent. So later on in season 8, we find out Mulder has a brain disease, okay? And yeah, it's stupid writing, all right? Because it's written by Chris Carter. But people, fans get pressed and they're like, Mulder would have told Scully that about his brain disease. And I'm like, why? He keeps things from her all the fucking time. And that's like from keeping his informants like deep throat or Mr. X from her, or holding onto her fucking ova without her knowledge or consent. Okay, and I gotta say, I would say of all the fucked up shit Mulder's done, this takes the goddamn cake, but also not really. Like, this is part of Mulder's behavior. He keeps things from Scully. I gotta say, I think this is one of the most insidious faucets of Mulder's behavior, is how he keeps things from her. And I think it's to have power and control over her. And that's just how I see things. Mulder and Scully have a fucking toxic relationship. And if you think they're the sparkle emoji blueprint of romance, you're fucking wrong. They have a fucking toxic relationship, okay? Cheers. Drink more water. I think my vlogs are just a complicated public service announcement to hydrate. So, he tells her this. Scully, understandably, is bewildered and pissed off. And I really want her to punch him in the fucking throat right now, because that would be too good for him. All right. I just really want her to kick him in the crotch hard. So she's like, oh, this is great. Maybe I can get pregnant. He's like, LOL, nah, they said it's not, the eggs aren't viable. You know, probably, Mulder, because you walked around with them in your fucking pocket before you thought to take them to a goddamn facility. I hate this man right now. Okay, in most of the episodes of The X-Files, Mulder annoys me to infuriates me, but I don't usually just detest him. I hate him here. I fucking hate him here. Okay. So whatever I say about Mulder in the rest of this vlog, I'm not going to feel guilty about. So, you know, come for me. I don't fucking care. So then it cuts back to the present. Mr. Haskell is still like being a just annoying piece of shit to Doggett and Scully. And Doggett's like, hey, this Dr. Parenti called and I was talking to him and he's like, he seems to know a lot about you. Now, this is one of my favorite headcanons that I have in the X-Files, and that is that John Doggett does not know where babies come from. So Scully is getting kind of fat. Her hair and nails are wonderful. She pukes at odd times of the day. She has an aversion to certain smells and food. And she has an obstetrician. She's going to see an obstetrician routinely named Dr. Parenti. And Doggett is like, what does this mean? Well, I don't know, Doggett. What do you fucking think it means? Your partner might be pregnant. I want the, it's this video. I'm sure you know. If you've been on YouTube for the past 15 to 20 years, I'm sure you've seen this video. And it's this guy reading these Yahoo answers of people asking, am I pregnant? How is baby formed? And I want to do an animated PMV of John Doggett, like, say, just seeing Scully getting, like, fatter and fatter with her baby bump. And he's like, what is baby? John Doggett can't fucking get it. And I love how in this episode, Scully and Skinner fucking spell it out for the guy. And he's like, what could this mean? And I'm like, no. John Doggett's parents were those parents. And he was like, Daddy, where does babies come from? And his daddy was like, well, son, that's a very good question. And then he like points at something in the distance. He's like, look, son, a unicorn. John, little baby dog is like, where? And then his dad just fucking dips on him. And John Doggett never figures it out. He gets married. He has a wife. He has a son. And it never crosses his wool of like, I have a small human now. I don't know where the fuck it came from. John Doggett, bless him, he's a smart man, but he can't get this through his wool. So Skelly's like, Skinner calls Skelly and Doggett into his office. Mr. Haskell's there. Skinner's like, look, bro, you gotta stop harassing my FBI agents. You gotta leave my FBI kids alone, man. Skinner is always dad to his FBI children, but he cranks his dad energy up to fucking 12 in this episode. In season 8, he's like, I'm going to be a grandpa. I have to protect my daughter and her baby and her baby's stepdad. So Walter Sergei Skinner, what a guy, right? So definitely the fourth best character in this series. After Scully, Reyes, Doggett, Skinner. That's how I rate the characters in this series. And then Maggie Scully. I put Maggie Scully before Skinner, actually. So then my cat's at my feet. She's so precious. It's too hot for her to get in my lap. She's just a little baby. So Skinner tells Mr. Haskell, he's like, look, bro, you got to stop harassing my FBI children. This isn't cool. Mr. Haskell looks at Scully and he's like, hey, my wife died because of these experiments to put this alien baby inside of her. And he's like, there's other women out there. Scully's really nervous because she knows what she's been through. She was abducted like Mrs. Haskell. She's had these experiments done on her. She got cancer and she's afraid. Now, that fear, I think, every pregnant woman feels. Not that she has an alien baby, but that something like, is my baby okay? Is my baby healthy? The circumstances that happen in this episode and in this series of sexual assault, reproductive trauma, rape, having to carry your rapist baby, which is what happens to Scully. The way this series handles those as like a cute little sci-fi subplot really shows the way that this series views women and just how little input women had in this series. So Scully's at her apartment. She keeps having these flashbacks of Mulder. There's one flashback where this doctor, her obstetrician, Dr. Parenti, asks her, he's like, can you think of a donor you want, you know, to do the IVF treatment to have a baby? And she's like, ah, yes, I just have to think of a way to ask him. What I want her to say is, oh, yes, the man who held my ova without my knowledge or consent. Fuck Mulder. I can't say it enough. This is the episode where I fucking hate him, okay? How could Scully choose him after he did that to her? I will never understand it. All right, I can't understand it. He fucking betrayed her. She should never speak to him again, let alone choose him to father her baby. Anyway, Scully does. And you know what? I'm not in control of Dana Scully's life, but shit, it's a bad decision. So, her deadbeat baby daddy comes to her apartment, and she asks him to father her children. He has this weird fucking line. He's like, this could come between us. And I'm like, yeah, emotionally manipulate her some more, bro. I hate Mulder in this episode. I can't say it enough. So anyway, it comes back to the present, and there's a knock at her door, and it's this woman named Mrs. Hendershot, I think that's her name. She looks like Aunt Becky from Full House. For any of you 90s kids, you'll probably get that reference. The woman who played Aunt Becky actually turned out to be a piece of shit. So, you know, let me take that with a grain of salt. So anyway, Aunt Becky tells Scully, she's like, hey, my baby's in danger. She's heavily pregnant, like 9 months pregnant. And she explains to Scully, like, I can't trust my doctors because I'm carrying something that's not human. Scully takes her to this hospital of, like, these top obstetricians. She's like, you're going to be safe here. They're going to induce her labor. Before this, Skinner and Scully, honest to God, take John Doggett to a diner in the middle of the night to explain to him where babies come from. And he still can't fucking get it. It's even to the point where, like, Skinner is like, Scully's going to take a leave of absence. She's going to get fatter. And then she's going to lose a lot of weight all of a sudden. And she's going to have this tiny screaming human. And Doggett's like, what can this mean? At one point, Skinner looks at Scully and he's like, you're going to have to tell her, baby. And she's like, Dad, if he can't get it at this point, he doesn't deserve to be my partner. So she walks out in the street, and John Doggett follows her out. And again, the Doggett-Scully shipping bait in this episode is off the fucking charts. They stand out in the rain and yell at each other, which is, you know, things co-workers. Hashtag just co-worker things. And he's like, you're leaving me. I'm sad. Again, people, the fandom, many people in the fandom hate John Doggett because they see him as a replacement for Mulder, which he wasn't, and he isn't, and that's a fucking stupid reason. I mean, if you're gonna hate him, choose a better reason, right? So they, and again, people like see him as this like stick in the mud and this emotionless man. John Doggett is a fucking sop for Scully. Every time he's on screen, he's just fucking gazing at her. He's like, oh, I'm in love with this woman. There's a hole in my heart. But like, yes, please tell me about how he's emotionless and boring. I really want to say it. I'd say John Doggett's as much of a sop as Mulder, if not more so. He certainly respects Scully more than Mulder ever did and views her like as a human being. and respects her more than Mulder ever did, so I'll say that for him. But, you know, with Mulder, the bar's not on the floor. It's fucking buried in the core of the earth. So, anyway, John Doggett's sad. Scully goes off with Miss Hendershot. Again, Doggett's like, who is that woman Scully's with? Why is she with this pregnant lady? And she's going to this obstetrician to get herself seen. And Skinner just kind of like pats Doggett on the back. And he's like, don't worry about it, man. Don't worry about it. Like, Mr. Skinner's like going to have to show John Doggett a fucking textbook. And like, look, here's how the baby's made. Here's how it grows, John. Are you getting this? John's like, wow, this is amazing. John Doggett is kind of a himbo, like Mulder. Like, Scully's got a fucking type, is what I'm saying. So anyway, Scully goes to this hospital as, like, these top obstetricians. And the lead obstetrician is this, like, MILF, and she's fucking hot. She's got the little gray streak, and I'm like, mommy. Anyway, Miss Hendershot's labor is induced. Scully goes in and has her ultrasound. And it's just, again, this really wonderful moment of Scully, like, looking at her baby. The doctor's like, do you want to know the sex? And Jillian's voice breaks. Like, she's like, I just want to make sure he's healthy. And I'm like, oh my God, Jillian's acting. Jesus Christ. This woman carried the show on her fucking back for 2 seasons. And David Duchovny couldn't carry the show on his own for 2 fucking episodes. So, you know, but isn't David like the best actor? Isn't that the argument? And again, it's just, it's a moment that makes me so happy, but just makes me so sad. Like, all of this is going to be taken away from Scully. Just, I guess, for being a woman on this show. Like, because, like, okay, Chris Carter created perhaps the greatest woman character of all time, just to continually abuse and traumatize her and steal every moment of joy she could have away. So, but isn't Chris Carter like the greatest feminist? I keep hearing that. I don't know. Like, I keep forgetting that. Sorry. I know I'm just an uncultured swine. Like, he is the greatest feminist, right? So anyway, Scully sees that her ultrasound has been videotaped. Like, there's a videotape in the VCR where her ultrasound is, we're assuming, is being recorded. And she pops it out and it's another woman's ultrasound. Scully freaks the fuck out. She's like, we can't trust these people. She goes and gets Miss Hendershot and they leave. And that's when Noel fucking Roar shows up. People gonna be talking about Mulder Krychek, Scully Reyes, Skinner Krychek, Skinner Mulder, Mulder Scully. Ain't nobody gonna be talking about Doggett and fucking Noel Roar. But Noel Roar is John Doggett's, quote, informant. But the way their relationship is framed is like Mulder and Deep Throat. And we all know that Deep Throat was Mulder's sugar daddy. So Noel Roar and John Doggett are boyfriends. Even the way they talk in this episode, where Noel Roar is like, why are you so interested in this? And John Doggett like gets kind of nervous and he's like, he fiddles with his tie and he's like, this is for the woman I'm partnered with. And Noel Roar's like, bro, you got a girlfriend? He's like, bro, you're bisexual and you never told me? And John Doggett's like, yes, Noel, I'm a character in The X-Files. Of course, I'm fucking bisexual. So anyway, Noel Roar is there because John Doggett's like, we can't trust these people. Like, they might hurt Scully. They might hurt Miss Hendershot. He sends Noel Roar there to get Scully. Scully goes with Noel Roar. And Mrs. Hendershot goes with her. Why does she go with them? So she doesn't know who he is. And I would say this is out of character for Scully, but she is with a pregnant woman. She is pregnant herself. She has just had this amniotic procedure done. And she's scared. like she has to get out of this place as quickly as possible. And I think that's part of her decision to go with Nolroar. She's like choosing between the two devils is basically what she's doing. I think what she thinks with Nolroar is like, this baby will at least be delivered safely. These people will probably fucking kill it. So, and also Skelly's coping mechanism now that Mulder's gone is kind of falling back on his reckless behavior. You see that in Roadrunners. You see it in Bad Law. That's kind of how she's fucking dealing with this. Excuse me. That's my explanation for it. And it's probably bad writing. Okay. Like, Nolroar could have proven, like, oh yeah, me and John Doggett, we go way back. And she would have gone with him. I think that would have been a better way to do that. Anyway, can you tell this episode's written by Chris Carter? I can. She goes with Nolroar. They're in the Jeep. Miss Hendershot goes into labor because, yeah, that's how labor works, right? You can so tell this series is written by men who were not in the delivery room with their wives or didn't have wives or didn't have children. You see it in Existence. It's like, we need the baby to show up now. Here it comes. I'm like, fuck you. It really, yeah, me who was in labor for 12 hours and then had to get a C-section. I'm like, yeah, that's how childbirth totally works. Anyway, Miss Hendershot goes into labor. Scully tries to attend to her, and Nolroar grabs Scully. And again, like, the treatment of women in this episode really shows this series' view of women, like, and how they view women. Like, just the abuse and handling and mistreatment of pregnant women in this episode pisses me the fuck off. Scully tries to fight her. He's like, this is for your own good. And I'm like, get your fucking hands off of her. I hate you. Mrs. Hendershot gives birth, and you hear that alien baby's cry. It's like if Chewbacca had a baby. It's like, my cat's sitting here looking at me. She's like, you fucking idiots. You want to come up? Come up here. Mommy's a fucking idiot, isn't he? Is mommy a fucking idiot? Mommy's a fucking idiot. So she's like, mommy. She's like, mom, you're a fucking idiot. So my cat just judged me hardcore. Yes, I'm wearing cat ears. I know. She's like, you fucking stupid human. That's pretty much how all cats view humans. They're like, god damn you, human. If you didn't feed me, I'd fucking eat you. So, I know. I'm a fucking idiot. I'm sorry. So, the baby alien cries, and his cries live rent-free in my nightmares. And then Skelly blacks out because Nolroar, the piece of shit, gives her a sedative because women can't have autonomy of their own in this show unless it's centered around a fucking man named Mulder. And she comes to in the hospital room. And again, John Doggett, bless the man, he's like, you were pregnant? And it's like, surprised Pikachu face. Were you pregnant? How is baby form? Scully's like, yeah, bro, I'm pregnant. Don't know what gave it away. I'm glad you got there, though, buddy. John Doggett still doesn't know where babies come from. And then Scully's like, he's like, why didn't you tell me? Again, what a sop of a man. And Scully's like, I was afraid they would use this against me and I couldn't find Mulder. And then John Doggett, man, best fucking guy. He's like, I'm in love with this woman and I want a relationship with her, but I'm gonna respect her. This is what she wants. And he's like, I will help you find your partner. I made that promise. And I'm like, how do people hate this man? He is fucking honorable. Like, John Doggett is 20 times more honorable than Mulder. Mulder, like, yeah, but they're like, oh, spooky boy. But I'm like, Doggett's better. Okay, go off. And then Scully goes back to her apartment. And we have another flashback. And Mulder comes in, and this is the flashback. And she's like, the IVF didn't take. She's like, this was the last chance. Then Mulder kisses her on the forehead, and he says, never give up on a miracle. And this line drives me up a fucking wall. And I'm going to tell you why it fucking does. Okay, so first of all, we're putting this flashback in early to mid season 6, which is just hilarious because season 6 is the season where Mulder probably treated Scully like garbage the most. Like, holy shit, right? Also, this, Mulder has gone on record stating that he doesn't believe in miracles. He thinks they're bullshit. Okay? And he has continually gaslit Scully over her own belief in miracles. Which, by the way, I just want to point out, every time Scully's like, I believe in this miracle, she's fucking right. All right? How many times did Mulder believe in something and he was wrong? Versus how many times Scully believed in something and she's right. She's right every fucking time. Do you hear that, Mulder stands? Scully's right every fucking time she believes. Unlike Mulder, who gets hoodwinked. Okay, but Mulder tells her, like, no, this is bullshit. And he gaslights her about these beliefs that are very important to her. About her faith, which she values very highly. But in this scene, he's like, never give up on a miracle. Now this, many fans say, well, this is Mulder's acceptance of Scully's beliefs and that he's like, hey, I don't believe in this, but I believe in you, which I think is really good. Like, it's like in the episode in the revival, Nothing Lasts Forever, Mulder tells her that. He's like, I don't believe in a God, but I believe in you. That would have been a good time for him to insert this here. Like, that would have been good. My problem is this. This comes on the heels of the episode All Souls, where Mulder is a donkey's dick to Scully about her belief in miracles. And directly after this comes the episode Orison, where he is just a piece of shit to her about it. Both times, I just want to say, Scully's fucking right. And she proves to Mulder that she's right. And he still fucking acts this fucking way, even though Scully never gaslit Mulder in this way. Okay? Yeah, again, and I've said this before, name the time Scully didn't try to meet Mulder halfway on his batshit insane theories. And you know how many times he tried to meet her halfway? That's how many times. Okay? But then he's like, never give up on a miracle. And I'm like, fuck you, you fucking stupid man. I fucking hate you. All right? This is after he fucking stole her ova and kept it from her without her knowledge and consent, and I'm never gonna fucking let it go. Mulder is trash. On that alone, he's trash. Okay. And that's the episode Permanum. It's an episode that fucking sucks, but there's moments in it I actually kind of love. Follow me on Twitter. I am at raccoons_dead. Follow me on Tumblr. I am at Just Awful X-Men Art. Follow me on Instagram. I am at Dead Raccoons Draws It. And follow me here on YouTube. I am taking art commissions. Look at my bio on Twitter, on Instagram, on DeviantArt. Also, I am at Dead/Raccoons. And just tell me what you want. I will draw it. And I will be at X-File Fest this September. It is going to be a huge fucking party in Minneapolis. I'm going to get to meet Annabeth Gish. I really hope I don't throw up when I meet her. that would be really embarrassing. But if I don't throw up, I'll get her to give me her autograph. I'm so excited about meeting her. And there's going to be some other fucking awesome people like Darren Morgan and Melinda McGraw. And I'm just so excited to be going and seeing all my peeps. I'm going to make a t-shirt that says Mulder and Scully's werewolf daughter so people will know me. And werewolf ears. I'll see you guys later. I love you. Mwah! Look out for aliens.